There's a goal of the elite, which is to create a one world government.
This plot to control the entire world politically and economically was first revealed in my first book titled Who's Who of the Elite, members of the Bilderberg Council on Foreign Relations and Trilateral Commission.
As World War II was drawing to a close, a new world organization was conceived, the United Nations.
You members of this conference are to be the architects of a better world.
John D. Rockefeller Jr.'s early backing of the League of Nations in the 1920s demonstrated the Rockefeller family's commitment to international peaceful cooperation. The Rockefeller family considered offering part of their own estate, Pocantico, and adjoining properties for the headquarters site. No decision had been made when the UN convened in the fall of 1946. The Rockefeller family was more concerned than ever with bringing the UN to New York City.
And there was big news in the last days as headlines told another story. The gift of a site by John D. Rockefeller Jr. for a permanent world capital in New York.
The Rockefeller gift changed the course of history and brought the United Nations to New York City. It is a gift which gave practical and moral support to the young United Nations, thus enabling it to succeed where the League of Nations had failed.
And the Rockefeller family's commitments to the United Nations did not end with this exceptional gift. It continues to the present day, and it is personified by David Rockefeller.
Now, the Global Union is made up essentially of four regions. The first region is called the European Union. The second region to be formed under the Global Union is called the African Union.
The African Union, or the AU, and it's made up of one governing body. They have one peacekeeping force, one central bank, one court of justice, and one currency.
The third region to be brought under the Global Union is one that they will later call the American Union.
Back in 1965, when David Rockefeller created the Council of the Americas, and it's made up of all the nations of North, Central, and South America and the Caribbean islands, with the exception of Cuba. January 1994, when the NAFTA, or North American Free Trade Agreement, was implemented, and the next phase will be what they call CAFTA, or the Central American Free Trade Area. The final establishment of the Free Trade Area of the Americas is scheduled for completion at least by December 31st, 2004. They will then change the name to the American Union, and this will be officially done somewhere in the year 2005 or 2006.
The next region of the Global Union will be the Pacific Union.
In November 1989, the Asian Pacific Economic Cooperation, or APEC, was founded and made up of all the nations of the Pacific Rim.
Since the day he took office, President Clinton has placed job creation and open and fair trade at the very center of our economic strategy. As you all know so well, he fought to ratify NAFTA and to complete the GATT-Uruguay round. He unified the leaders of the Asia-Pacific region to form there a commitment to open trade. And quite recently, he and the leaders of the European Union have committed to build a new transatlantic marketplace with more open markets and more job creation. At the Miami summit, coming down to what interests us most, he helped to shape the consensus to negotiate a free trade area of the Americas that will encompass a $12 trillion market of 850 million consumers. His aim is to make this hemisphere an even more dynamic hub of the global economy, to open markets, to create jobs, and to lift living standards throughout this vital region. We remain on track to achieve by 2005 a free trade area of the Americas, which has begun to be called for shorthand purposes an FTAA.
We live in a global society. We must understand it. We must comprehend the forces that are affecting it. And we must act forcefully to protect our own interests as well as to promote the continued progress of all the world's peoples. It was pointed out at the conference that growth is most efficiently managed by the private sector, but regulation of the process by national governments and international bodies is also needed. And once again, the United Nations should certainly be among the catalysts and coordinators of this process. But in addition, given the importance of unencumbered international trade in stimulating and facilitating economic growth, some of the newer economic entities, such as the European Economic Community, NAFTA, APEC, and most importantly, GATT, now known as the World Trade Organization, are probably best suited to play a major role in ensuring sustainable development.
At this time last year, there was shrill voices on the left and on the right criticizing almost in a cynical way our collective efforts of hemispheric integration. Some claimed the summit of the Americas in Miami was little more than a glorified photo opportunity. Some question our real commitment to the implementation of the summit agenda and plan of action. And some called us wrong-headed or at least naive in thinking that we could fundamentally change and reorient hemispheric relations based on truly shared values and common interest. Well, as the old song goes, what a difference a year makes. It is fair to say that the summit has cemented a new consensus based on democracy and open markets. Let me say very clearly that we are not focused, as some have suggested, on establishing a new world order, but rather bringing order to a new world.
In 1998, the Rockefeller family was worth $11.48 trillion, and the Rothschild family is worth somewhere between $100 and $400 trillion, possibly more. And they get this tremendous wealth because they own the central banks of all the nations in the world, except the rogue nations. And when they need money, they simply just print it. It's not backed by gold or silver or anything of value. The U.S. State Department has called several nations rogue nations. And their definition of a rogue nation is any nation that harbors or finances terrorists.
And a few, such as Iraq, Iran, and Castro's Cuba, have governments that actively oppose the premises upon which that system is based.
Now, if we look at the current nations on this list, one is Cuba, North Korea, Afghanistan. By the way, the elite established a central bank in Afghanistan in the year 2002. One of their objectives. The other, another rogue nation is Iraq. We've invaded Iraq and they've already established a central bank. Syria, Iran, Sudan, Libya, and Pakistan.
To make it clear to the outlaw states that they cannot prosper at the expense of the rest, they must either reform or suffer in isolation.
Now, rather than harboring or financing terrorists, the only common thread between all these rogue nations is that none of these nations allowed the international bankers to own their central bank. That's the real reason that they're called rogue nations.
In organizing the council in 1965, David and his colleagues were among the first to grasp the enormous consequences and possibilities for the economic and political progress throughout the Americas. A free trade area of the Americas, up and running by January of 2005. The President strongly committed to this goal, and all of our trade efforts are pointed in this direction.